God gave me his only begotten son. That's how I survived in these dirty rotten slums. God gave me. Praise be Jesus Christ, now and forever. Hey, my brothers and sisters of Christ, I'd like to thank you guys for joining me for another week of Sunday readings with Charlie the Catholic. I'd like to take this opportunity again to thank everyone who takes the time to watch these videos and dive into the scripture with me, and especially to everyone who takes the time to share this video. I appreciate it a lot. You might notice a few developments now. You know, we got a theme song, you know, intros, some intro music. We also, the viewership, the views are going up little by little, you know. All praise be to Jesus Christ, now and forever. Thanks be to God for this. You know, this is something I'm trying to do to further the kingdom, to spread the gospel. You know, I want to be a light that shines in the darkness, that others are drawn to the light of Christ. You know, may I decrease and Christ increase. All right, today is the fifth Sunday in ordinary time. Some of you might go to Mass in extraordinary form. In that case, today is the Sexagesima Sunday. I go to the Novus Ordo, or the ordinary form of the Mass, and today is fifth Sunday in ordinary time. And our first reading comes from the book of Job. I know it looks like it spells job, but it's pronounced Job. Rhymes with robe. A little bit of information about Job. Job was a righteous man, a holy man, had a good relationship with God. And one day, God told the devil, "Hey, did you see my servant Job? You know how good he is." And the devil told God, "He's only good because you give him all this good fortune. You know, you gave him his family and all this and that. And of course he's going to serve you. But take that away and then watch him curse you." And God permitted the devil to allow Job to go through some hardship. Job lost his everything, his wealth, his family. He ended up with boils on him. Things were going bad, you know. Where his wife was saying, "You'd be better off dead. Just curse God and die already." But even through all this, Job did not curse God. He took his hardship. "God gives me life. He gives me good. Can he give me bad too and not take it?" So you must take the good with the bad. And that brings us to the first reading where Job is speaking. All right, here we go. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. A reading from the book of Job. "Is not man's life on earth a drudgery? Are not his days like those of a hireling? He is a slave who longs for the shade, a hireling who waits for his wages. So I have been assigned months of misery, and troubled nights have been told off for me. If in bed I say, 'When shall I arise?' then the night drags on. I am filled with restlessness until the dawn. My flesh is clothed with worms and scabs. My skin cracks and festers. My days are swifter than a weaver's shutter. They come to an end without hope. Remember that my life is like the wind. I shall not see happiness again." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This was Job chapter 7, verses 1 through 7. For some reason, the church took out verses 5, which is a little graphic. Maybe that's why, but it tells about his flesh with the scabs and his skin cracking. Maybe the church is like, maybe we don't need to hear that part. But you know me, I'm going to give it to you. Full blown, all the meats and potatoes, everything. All right, let's move on to today's psalm reading. Today's psalm reading comes from Psalm 147. Hallelujah! How good to celebrate our God in song. How sweet to give fitting praise. The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem, gathers the dispersed of Israel. heals the brokenhearted, binds up their wounds, numbers all the stars, calls each of them by name. Great is our Lord, vast in power, with wisdom beyond measure. The Lord sustains the poor, but casts the wicked to the ground. And today we have second reading coming from St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians.
For if I preach the gospel, that gives me no ground for boasting, for necessity is laid upon me. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my preaching I may make the gospel free of charge, not making full use of my right in the gospel. For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a slave to all, that I might win the more. To the Jews I became as a Jew, in order to win Jews. To those under the law I became as one under the law, though not being myself under the law, that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law I became as one outside the law, not being without law toward God, but under the law of Christ, that I might win those outside the law. To the weak I became weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessings.
The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And today's gospel reading comes again from St. Mark. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark. Glory to you, O Lord.
And immediately he left the synagogue and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law lay sick with a fever, and immediately they told Jesus of her. And he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and the fever left her, and she served them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered together about the door. He healed many who were sick with various diseases, and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak, because they knew him. In the morning, a great while before day, he rose and went out to a lonely place, and there he prayed. Simon and those who were with him pursued him, and they found him.
Everyone is searching for you.
Let us go on to the next towns, that I may preach there also, for that is why I came out.
And he went throughout all Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and casting out demons.
The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, Lord Jesus Christ. You know, I want to go back to the book of Job. You know, he was speaking about the hardships of the human experience. We all experience hardship. We all experience what the word he used in scripture is drudgery, or other translations put hard service. And I'm reminded of the fall and what God told Adam, which he tells us, because we inherit original sin. Therefore, this goes to us as much as to Adam. God said, cursed be the ground because of you, and toil you shall eat its yield all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles shall bring forth to you as you eat of the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat until you return to the ground from which you were taken. For you are dirt, and to dirt you shall return. That was what God told Adam after the fall. And that's our experience in life. You know, we have to work. Some translations say, by the sweat of your brow, you will toil with the ground to eat, to make your bread. It's just part of life. We're gonna have struggles, you know. That's part of the bad news, you know. It's part of the bad news because we sin. What makes even worse, more of the bad news, is the wages of sin. The wages of sin are death, eternal death. And, you know, we have such a gracious, merciful God that, you know, he told Adam and Eve that if they would eat from the tree of knowledge and evil, that they would die. But they didn't die instantly. Scripture says they lived a long life. Eventually, they did die. But now here goes the good news. Through Christ Jesus, we have life. So although Adam and Eve died, today I tell you, I submit to you that they are still alive. They are alive in heaven because Christ redeemed them. Christ is the good news, you know? It's like Paul was saying in today's letter. In other words, what Paul was getting at was he's saying he shouldn't brag for doing something he should already be doing. Should not brag about what you should be doing already, and woe to you and to me if we don't do it. You know, and what is that? What is it that we got to do? At the end of Mass, what is it the deacon or the priest says? The Mass is over. Go forth and proclaim the gospel, or go forth and spread the good news. And we say, thanks be to God. We're being entrusted with a commission. We have to go out and evangelize. You know, we cannot keep our faith to ourselves. We must share it in a hope to bring others. So at the end of our earthly lives, when we go to heaven, we're not going to heaven alone. There's some people that we, through the grace of God, helped get there. And probably there's people through the grace of God that helped us get there. You know, we're a communion, a community, you know, the communion of saints. And, you know, go forth and preach the gospel. That's something we're all entrusted with. Also, Paul mentions about, you know, doing it for free. But there are those who do this full time, and they do deserve, like priests, bishops, they deserve a salary. You know, they do this full time working for the kingdom. You know, some people are called to that. And in today's gospel reading, we hear of Jesus healing St. Peter's mother-in-law. And this reminds me of a joke. May he rest in peace, my uncle, Deacon Prudencio Perez. One day he goes, hey, Charlie, you know, St. Peter denied Jesus, you know, in his passion. Yeah. He goes, you know why he really denied him? Why? Because he remembered that he healed his mother-in-law. You know, I get it. There's a joke. A lot of people have, you know, bad relationships with their mother-in-laws. You see on sitcoms, you know, all the husbands don't get along with their mother-in-laws. But I like to say I'm very, very blessed to have a great mother-in-law. My mother-in-law is the best. I love her so much. I'm just happy my mother-in-law is a good one. And there's a couple facts we could take from this verse that don't jump out right away. And one is St. Peter and St. Andrew, who are brothers, lived together at the house of St. Peter and St. Andrew. Another is if St. Peter had a mother-in-law, obviously he must have been married. But what we can't say is that his wife was there, because they didn't say that. So we don't know if he was married and she might have died. You know, he might have been a widower. We don't know. That part's just not in the verses. We're left to wonder, you know, where was his wife during this event where his mother-in-law was healed? The fever immediately left her. and she served them. She gave them hospitality, you know, probably made some snacks and refreshments, you know. Well, that's a couple things we could see in the gospel that we could take some facts. Another thing we see is that the word spread out, that Jesus, you know, last week we heard about him. He did an exorcism, you know, and the word got out. He healed St. Peter's mother-in-law today. So now people throughout the town are bringing their people who are weak, people who are sick with diseases, people who are possessed with demons. Everyone's coming to Jesus. And that's what I want to invite you guys this week. This is what I think Scripture's telling us. Let's bring our loved ones to Jesus. You know, right now in my family, we have a tragedy looming on both sides of my family, on my mother's side and my father's side. You know, my father has brothers. My Uncle Junior is in the hospital. Please pray for him. You know, he's suffering from dementia. And he's not himself no more, you know. We went to go see him. So heartbreaking. This is such a hard cross for someone to bear. You know, I try to tell him, I hope you understood. There's nothing worse than wasted suffering. Take that suffering that you've gone through and give it back to God. Unite it to Jesus and give it back to him. You know, that we also have on my mom's side of the family, my Aunt Barbara. Barbara Herbert, I love you so, so much, my dear Titi. I'm bringing you to Jesus, like today's gospel readings. I'm bringing you to him. God, please heal my aunt. Heal her. I love her dearly. She means so much to us all. You know, and I want to also stress that, you know, the healing for this life is temporary. But what's more important is a conversion for eternal life, you know. So in addition to asking for physical healing for these family members of mine, I'm also asking for a conversion so that they may come to know God, serve God, and be with God forever in the next life. All right, everyone, thanks again for joining me. God willing, we'll see you next week. I love you. He's dirty about the slum. God gave me.